configuring it to our collecting ideas for problems. Should be a brainstorming talk to instead of a presentation, because the presentation we already did.
Yes,
alright.
So, do you need to be running Debian in order to make Debian IFTD?
Not exactly.
You need the shell and you need CD Bootstrap. And CD Bootstrap has a static binary. That means as long as you can execute that,
Okay. I'm running Ubuntu.
Ubuntu is anyway no problem.
Yeah. And I had previously made a live CD with just GNOME Sword. And we were really cramped for space. And I'd like to see. Maybe you know the answer already. Would it be smaller if I rolled it in Debian than it would be in GNOME?
Okay.
But the GNOME is like it's a desktop environment. You can rip it out and it'll get a lot smaller. The base of Debian is only like 100.
Megs or something?
120
megs. Yeah, okay, but I want to run GNOME Sword, so I have to have GNOME.
What's GNOME Sword?
It's a program that uses GNOME.
Oh, yeah.
If you just need one program, then you go to standard. If you only need one additional package, except the low level stuff to boot, then you select standard and say one package more. And then we use app as always, and this puts in all your commands. So you don't need to, as long as you stay with Debian, you don't have any choice to say, I don't want that GNOME package or that GNOME package, because as soon as you select one, you get automatically all required depends put in anyway. So this is pretty easy for you.
But you started. I'm lower than you started higher than where I'm at.
If you
started with just use the standard package. I don't know how to do that.
Each Debian package has a priority that can be extra or optional or required. That's more technical. There is a type which means essential, is essential, and if a package is essential, you need it in order to boot.
Okay.
Except
what I'm asking you,
if I
bring up terminal, after I've got terminal up, what's the first thing that I need to type?
Wait, I want to explain you what you have, why you have it to boot. Then I tell you how to boot.
Yeah, okay.
So what you need is just the standard selection, and standard means each package of priority standard or higher. That's what you need for the basic system that it boots and that you can use network.
Yeah, okay.
And then you tell this selection, and you say, give me an additional package which is GNOME Sword or whatever.
Uh-huh.
And then, as apt pulls in all the required packages, you don't care about them because they're just depends. They're put in. So you do call makelife with flag p, dash p standard to select the standard list which you want, and then dash dash package and for example GNOME Sword, and that's all.
Do you understand?
Yeah, well, what about getting, just running through an example on the project?
Right. Yeah, yes,
it's pretty. We could all do the same example, so if you install live helper from live.debian.net, it's pretty easy
to show
for
example.
You can use my.
Yeah.
What
okay.
My
unit. Okay, we have a big chars, characters.
A big what?
Big font.
Oh. Well, I got an expert, font expert, sitting right next to me.
What are you both doing?
anyone have specific questions rather about slide building?
Can you build a live CD with also access in store? So you can
switcher comes up down here on the bottom right, so they can change between, I don't know, Hiragana and Katakana or whatever it's called.
Do you have the config to show?
And I do the config. The config is in svn.debian.net.
Ah, okay.
.org, sorry. It's all free software and on the Subversion repository. And of course, to shut this down, all you have to do is hold down the power button.
Okay. Yes, some of the configurations are in the Subversion.
Yeah. There's my configurations and Daniel's configurations, and they're very good starting point because they actually work.
to start a new project, you could make live config. This builds a default configuration tree that you can navigate. If you have installed a live helper, you could try this right now and show look at the tree. The tree should be some sort of easy to navigate and configure. The configuration files of the four phases, the bootstrap phase, have a separate config file, so you can customize the bootstrap phase. Then you could customize the chip through the building phase. The binary phase is the term we use to create the final image. So an ISO image.
Or USB image.
Yes.
Or NetBoot image.
NetBoot Turbo. The NetBoot Turbo is constructed of two directories, one to easily configure the server you would like to use to distribute those network images, and the other part is the root FS that as a default it is for the network system as a plain directory, so no compressed file. No file image, just a bunch of files that you could put on your server. And some things that you could need to prepare a custom system are custom boot screens, maybe.
Yeah, I put a custom boot screen. When you boot up a CD, you can put in a whole load of cheat codes, which are documented somewhere,
yeah,
on the wiki page probably. Like there's one cheat code which is quite cool called 2RAM, which basically loads the CD into memory, into the RAM, sorry. Same thing. And once it's all booted up, you can take the CD out and boot it onto another machine with the 2-RAM option, and use the CD and boot another machine. So instead of having the machine in there all the time, you can take the CD out, which is good for some like kiosks, because they're worried that people might run away and steal the CD or something stupid.
And it runs a lot faster from
Yeah, it runs a lot faster, right? I'm going to do it right now, but it does take a little bit of time to copy into RAM, I think, because it reads the whole thing. So the initial boot up takes a few, like a minute longer than it should be.
Cursor anymore.
But this is pretty quick though. The USB version is like 1 minute to load. USB-C version is like 2 minutes to load. It's pretty quick.
It is the USplash theme?
Yeah, from Ubuntu. Don't ignore it.
You can change the...
I haven't got the artistic skills to do some nice artwork for a new splash screen, so I'm working on that. So yeah, the boot parameter is an important part of where you pass arguments, especially with these things.
If you are trying right now and those Maclay config and stuff and have some question about how to do your particular custom live, just ask.
It's pretty easy to do your own splash image and stuff. We've all done that before. So, anything specific, guys? Petr, what do you think you're doing now?
Well, I know Holger did some work on the live CD for DVMU, and for the easy things, I think it was just specifying the patch list and run our configuration on it. For the hard part, which would make a lot more useful, is to provide different profiles for different live boots from the same image, I think. So you have like a server live image and a client live image booting from the same image.
We can do that. It's just as most of the things in LiveDelco, it's just lack of time means. Like in LiveDelco supports these partial images on the same media. We just need to tell LiveDelco to create those in automatic fashion. It's just, at the moment it's a matter of priority. I tried last week to fix Yaboot, but because of lacking hardware, I couldn't finish it. So next week I finish this, and afterwards I look into the next step. And it's somewhere on my to-do list, somewhere in the middle. So that means 2 weeks from now.
But you could build it some sort of manually now, and live image RAM FS will output will look for a module.config name file. The exact name is on the man page, and there are a list of which. Different file images should be UnionFS together.
Right.
So you could provide on the same media different lists for different boot methods. And if you use Grub as a bootloader, you could do different boot with different boot parameters that tell live UnionFS to look at different files. That means different list and different results of the root FS.
Right.
yes, as Daniel said, the code to do that automatically at build side is in work in progress that should be finished. But those live in interim FS. Thing could open the road to also multi-arch and multiple different boot type on the same media.
I mean, the long-term target for Lenny is to have at the same time when Lenny ISO schedule is that we have double menu utility, which offers live sessions for x86, 7064 Power PC at the same time, with all three desktops, including source, which makes it, of course, the possibility to install these desktop images. And then you have the alternative disk you want to give away. Right. And hopefully, when Lenny gets released, dual layer DVDs are cheap. So, yes.
And anyone who's looking for practical deployments like X, X detection is pretty damn good, actually, even in Edge. So, if you're going to make the Debian ICs and hope that people use them, they have quite a good chance, I think, of getting a working system going pretty quickly. With X working, sound working.
And if you're not happy with the default X detection from the XOR practice, you can actually install XDev Configurator, which is doing a slightly better job.
Yes.
It can be, it can configure X during boot, so it will work for live CDs, and it actually is default in NTSP.
That's good. Yeah. That's good.
It's a parameter, but we don't use it as default because we don't want to diverge from Debian by default. We offer all the fancy stuff you can ever imagine, but by default we do only that parts which Debian does default too. Otherwise it will create another distribution if we don't want to do that.
But now if you install xdevconf on your target system, when the init ramfs is generated, it look for the presence of xdevconf, and if present, it puts it under init ramfs. Then you could activate it with the boot parameters. So if your CD does not boot X on a particular machine, you could try also the xdevconf way route.
Well, it depends on your point of view. As far as I can see, it's part of standard Debian, it's in main, but it's not activated by default because no one actually had time to integrate all the code into the default.
Nobody had time.
Yeah.
Okay.
And for Lenny, it's probably going to be a waste because XORG is going to do it automatically on its own, so hopefully you can get rid of the entire configuration part.
Yeah, so we would like to integrate all the things that could lead to prepare a complete DVD for giving at the boot at the event. So we could have a live DVD, multi-hard DVD with installer, live system, and maybe also with his help. In something valuable for Windows users, so they put his DVD or CD inside their machine, and something happens that shows the power of that.
Yeah. Who's working on that?
He has
just basically providing a small other run stuff from people. Whereas I've been using it, I want to run the system run in the virtual machine.
Yeah.
So I can just evaluate.
Yeah,
some big warning, this is going to be slow because it's human.
Well, I was thinking of doing a goodbye Windows where you dump the answer to the Windows file system and editing the menu.
It can be an option. Could you look at it before running, so
is it easy to add the like OpenOffice, Firefox primaries on the RCD?
Yes.
Or you put the CD in and it pops up with do you want to install OpenOffice, click
no, it's about Firefox. It's about just copying QEMU for Windows. So people this menu coming and says I want to run this Debian Live CD in a QEMU virtual machine.
Why?
So I don't even have to reboot my machine to test it.
Right?
Yes. By the way, do you know when the full out of ground drop to run? Win32 loaded from Rocket Milan. It is a small Windows binary, you click on it, it downloads the NetInstall image, configures your booting on Windows, you restart and puts it into the disk. Your install CD is a bit tricky because you need to have partitions.
Whereas here, we just have to say.
Yeah, I know.
sorry, we have the ISO image, we have a CD, so we don't need any partition at all.
But if you do so, if you do the same for Leipzig, you get the Windows log, which says Windows blah blah blah, and an entry above saying my fancy Leipzig, and it runs at native speed.
Yeah.
That was the point I wanted to point.
Yeah.
And the only disadvantage I have is that it's actually good and true.
Yeah.
Which I personally think is worse, but yes.
Well, I'm going to do that. I'm going to try that way. That thing's pretty easy.
I think it's about getting to the best opportunity for Windows users to try.
Yeah.
It's way.
I'm a bit worried that Kate.
Well, people it's not too good by default, but maybe some people building a Debian live CD would want to have it.
My question was actually to what are your what's your opinion about not doing anything like this? Because it's easier because you don't have to do it.
It's just one.
Yes, because getting into the BIOS could be scary.
No, you don't have to go into the BIOS. You go into the Windows load.
Yes, like that one. We have also the boot parameter that does half of the work for it. But also, instead of 2 RAM, we could use 2 disk, Apple, some partition, and the live media is copied on the partition.
Yeah,
so if we just added the code to integrate the Windows bootloader and to load that, they could choose from the Windows bootloader which kind of system they want to boot. The live system from their hard disk partition for live init RAM FS is not really here for writing on NFTFS media because we need to use a fuse. And when changing the root, we need to protect fuse, which is a user process, to be killed before launching the new init. So there are some tricky points that need to be fixed. The read part it's okay because we could use the NTFS kernel module. So we don't need a user process for adding a partition mounted or a image file mounted.
I think you were both speaking about something completely different, and what we were speaking about is that, or what I should mention is that Robert asked some months ago if I have a look at his Windows loader with regard to the Windows loader, and I'm pretty sure because he's a nice guy. He will add as soon as we have the ISOs on CD image for the Windows log, I'm pretty sure he will add an entry so that you can choose do I want to download the net install or Leipzig for this boot entry. Then I think the Windows log is about kilobytes of size. So I think for Windows this is the almost easiest.
Software that does that.
But
change the boot.
So
the
user still have to reboot his computer to run.
Yes.
And he benefits of having very good speed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Especially
some people are reluctant to reboot, so Windows model.
You probably have to reboot the machine if you're still in KMU.
No.
You?
Yeah.
No?
Why would you?
This is Windows, right? You install something, it wants you to reboot it.
You don't have to install it. If it's exactly like in Linux. If you don't want, you don't have to install CatHuman.
Just the launcher.
The to move to the
Anyway, there's a few ways into it.
And if you don't, you can just run it.
What did you say, Carlos?
You just have a bad view of Windows.
Okay, I'm sure. Yeah, I'm sure it's got better since I last used it.
Wouldn't it a bit scare more people because of the speed of running QAMO instead of?
I think you have to have quite warning saying it's going to be slow because it's from the CD and because it's in the virtual machine.
Anyway, there's some exciting developments and there's a whole lot of ways that people can get on Debian now thanks to Debian Live.
And especially because the Windows load is probably to be integrated on the Linux i386, so that's the most easiest way to integrate it because it will be anyway pushed in.
But we need to tell about the other issues because that it could work because at the boot time it's not only looking for CDs. It live in it RAMFS scans for all block devices, so also hard disks and USB keys to look for a particular enabled directory which contains one or more file images. So this is why that solution could work. Also without the CD, we need just to patch the Windows bootloader and to do that.
I don't think that's an issue. It was
no, it's not an issue, it's just for letting know to people.
Maybe if it happens to be fine, just have a try and say,
First of all, a big problem for school Linux automatic building of the live CDs is that the build need to be done as root. And we would really, really want that. So if it's possible to build it without root or change the build system to avoid root, please do so. Is it possible?
We need ideas for that.
The problem is that you need to. The problem is in CD bootstrap. It does mount proc as root. If we don't actually need proc, it's possible to bootstrap without proc. I have asked Bastian some time ago, but didn't hear something back, and it wasn't so important for me. But I'll back him again, and it would be really nice if you can have CD bootstrap with a flag, no proc or whatever, and then you can run this user. As soon as you can do that, you can build a secure change root or whatever, just for the change routing mechanism. And everything else doesn't need root, so I'm really looking forward that Bastian can implement that.
Right. Is the same problem present with dbootstrap?
I don't use dbootstrap for several reasons. One is that it has more bugs than dbootstrap from my point of view. It does not create a full static dev directory. You can't compile bash in it, for example. And for me, it's very important that you can run live helper anywhere where you have a shell and see bootstrap static binding. And dbootstrap is not that portable as the static binding.
Right.
That's why I didn't try see dbootstrap so much. Maybe you know if it can done with
dbootstrap
without hacking it?
I don't know.
No, the box needs to mount root of within the change root. Out of the box or without touching it, it needs to mount proc from within the change root.
It depends on how proc mount, you
say. No, I say that out
it
of you would need to patch it as well to make it work.
Right.
But it's bash code, so it's easier.
But from the point of view that you don't want to modify packages, it sucks, so asking Adrian.
Well, dbootstrap was just added to the Debian installer subversion repository, so there is more people capable of modifying it, and the last 24 hours have seen a flow of patches to it, both from Ubuntu and from other people that has been waiting for a repository, I think. So, So it could be possible. And for for Debian Installer, we actually had to rewrite quite a lot of tools to be able to build it without root access. Like the mTools suite had to be rewritten to actually work on files instead of requiring devices. And all these kind of things. So it's possible to change the tools if the tools is a problem. And being able to build without root is quite important for the project on our project. The other question I had is, when you are booting a live system, it's useful to be able to store like local configuration. If you make an LDAP server and you want to be able to store the LDAP information somewhere, can you store it like on a USB stick or whatever storage area? Can you, for example, make a small partition on the hardware and store changes to the live file system there?
Okay, it is already supported. Four different manners in the Live Intra MFS. There is also a small utility, but which is which have many targets that are not all tested, well tested. But basically, there are the persistent feature. That means that your Union FS is based all over the collection of redundant file system, mostly one in standard builds, and the standard way is those file system redundant and RAM disk that gives the read write. Persistence means that instead of using a RAM disk, we use another partition or image file on a writable block device. So all changes made to the boot system, you could install packages, block files, are all persistent on that device. If you could bring this device with yourself, you could put it in on another machine and have your system as were working before. This is persistence. But have some problems with the USB keys that have a fixed number of writing possible. So we added also a snapshot type of persistence, which doesn't touch the Union FS. The Union FS is done like the standard way with the RAM disk, but requirements or at reboot or alt, copy the difference. Between copy the RAM disk, in fact, which contains the difference between the system that you use and the read-only parts of it on a writable device, partition, image file, or CPI or archive, SquashFS file. Those are the two systems. The third system is with read-only media like rewritable CDs or writable CDs with multi-session. You could add more SquashFS files on the boot image by adding a session. You could add your difference from previous run of the system on it. So you could launch your system, customize it, have those changes fixed on a compressed, put on the CD again in a multi-session type, or just remaster another one with two files, and then you could have those different recorder for future uses.
How easy is it to enable? Is it like you plug in a USB pin and it asks, do you want to store the state of this pin, or do you have to like run a thousand scripts and
it is a work in progress. My idea were to have a small GUI to do that. I just wrote a small shell script to do that. It is called live-snapshots,
but it is a little buggy for some targets. When it is complete, I will add a GUI, so the user could just click on resync or snap it, and the GUI ask from some parameters, like where, or it will try, my idea is also to try to auto-detect which could be the most probably USB stick partition to do the snapshot in.
I think we would need a very simple solution.
Yeah, for final users it should be simple, yes.
So make sure your grandmother can use it if you explain it over the phone. Then yeah, can use it.
Just click here, mom.
It's okay.
Just another question. Is it possible to have some database filled with data and put it in the LiveCD?
Yep.
For instance, yeah, of course. Can you a little bit more elaborate? So
sure, I show it.
Sorry for asking a question about yourself.
About USB booting, it only seems to work on newer machines.
Yeah.
So that's something to bear in mind. This, it is pretty cool to boot up from the USB, but it won't work on old machines, basically.
But by any old machine, new machines will be quite old, so...
You might sometimes get away with BIOS upgrades, fix it.
Or you could just boot those kernel image and the Unitram FS from other media, and then the Unitram FS scans for the USB. So you could have a floppy to stick in and boot it up.
Are there anyone working on a feature like you use the Windows Auto Run? You just plug in the USB stick, it loads everything in memory and boot from there. Even if the machine doesn't support USB,
it has to be something nice with the QEMU.
Well, not QEMU because it's slow, but just take over the machine, you plug it in and pop something.
Yeah, that's
I think that's
arduous.
I think that's called Win32 in boot, is that right?
But these things are fast. Like, you can put it into an X40 and have a usable system. You know?
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. And the boot up fast, of course.
You could partition your USB, have a redundant part and a right table part when you store your differences. If the partition or the image file on maybe these USB sticks have a particular name, after boot time, it will be recognized and we will try to add it as a persistent system or a snapshot system. Then all the things that are recognized at boot time, when you reboot or add, they were synced back. So your grandmother could, if you prepared the stick well, could use without clicking anywhere. Right now, not only the targets. Targets for a snapshot and persistence are the different way you could store those information. And the different way are a wall partition, an image file of a part of a partition that resides on another partition, also Windows 1, a CPIO compressed with gzip file, and the squash effects file. So you have four different targets that could be used to store the difference. But the live snapshot helper, which is a simple shell script, is not yet well tested. So it maybe breaks some uses. But you are all encouraged to try it and report, so...
Why so many options?
Because we had some different people needing different features, and we imagined different scenarios. Those live systems were used by people who need to boot from the network. Other people need to able to access those file system, those difference in another systems, those need a very small system, so CPIO archive, archive is doesn't get need this more depend a lot of dependency to work. It's all it could be used by a very small system. The other types need needed more modules or utilities, because, like SquashFS type need to have the SquashFS tools installed on the live system. Otherwise, it cannot resync back when shut down or halted. So we just put in all the stuff required, and we hope for the bugs to emerge and fix them.
Now, back to Andreas and your questions. As you know, LiveHelper is a ton of shell scripts. And you would need to know which one to run in order. Because this really sucks. We have a wrapper called mainline. You can use mainline with parameters like pkd-desktop. This builds you an image of, with kd-desktop task installed and does not ask further questions. If you, for example, want to specify the mirror, you would do this.
Okay. Yeah, we're going to want to install gnomes to KDE.
Yeah, well, wait.
Okay.
So it all works like this. You use parameters and it just works. If you need more, you can call it in two steps. First, lhconfig, which is similar to not yet tested on Ubuntu that much. we can hack around. That would have been the same result as calling lhconfig alone. Then you get this directory, which is called lhconfig, and in this directory you have a config directory, and in this directory there are a lot of config files. Like, no, I don't have any of this. As you see, there are for each stage there is an individual config file, like binary, bootstrap, change.com, and source. For individual helpers, you have a config directory. The most important ones are if you have a list of packages you want, like, I don't know, Doodle, then DWM or similar, and you don't want to specify them always with in this manner. This sucks, as you know, it gets you a very long command line. So use config files for this. And then you would do this. And you can add a whole bunch of individual config files, and all these packages stay in these files. Are installed in your change root. That's the alternative way instead of using command line options to make them. The same you see here. For example, in change root, you can specify all those dirty options. For example, which change root files you want to use in the image. If you want a compressed image, then you use SquashFS. If you want a second extended file system, you put it there, or you can use plain when you just want the files not compressed, but just copy it. Interactive is for debugging. If you want,
not
wow.
some books also the works.
You can add your funny package here. That's also the same, if you just have one more. You can select one of a selected list. Shipped lists are in user share. Let's say junior. Then you see it includes GNOME junior packages and the junior GNOME package. Here you see which packages these are exactly. So if you just want GNOME, you don't care, you just say give me packages GNOME and you end up with GNOME. You don't need to specify them individually. In the case you said before, you just want GNOME soft.
There's another package I've got on there called, and it's in the bar. It's called gnomeshort.deb.
How's it spelled?
Just no sword, all one word.
Like this?
No dash in the middle.
Okay, that's available. So you would just do a fresh configuration and add in the file in the file change root, you would do this. That's all. Then, once you have made everything, you can either call each stage after one, means something like this, or because you're lazy, you would just do this.
Okay.
Now that I have messed up with the config. Specified strange options.
What? Don't remove stuff.
I have root, I can do everything.
We're doing this all so fast.
In your case, I would ask GNOME. I would add GNOME desktop task because it's the most useful. And then that's all. Now it runs. You wait 10 minutes or however fast your machine is, and you end up with a nice image.
All right,
it's pretty easy.
Sufficient space in time.
Good.
It should be easy.
There are
so sufficient space in time.
It should work,
it has 11
free.
While it's building, what was that? Live security variable and security updates mentioned?
In some cases it doesn't make sense, in some not cases, it doesn't make sense to have the security updates included.
From the security repository?
Yes. It just says that it doesn't include these mirrors if they are configured. Another thing is you can use, you can disable apt secure. In some cases, if you want to build really small images, you don't want to have GNOME PGP on the ICD. Otherwise, you end up with a couple of dependencies. If you want to go below 50 megabytes, you have to exclude it. And for some users this is important because they do really small images, and that's why LiveHelper supports it, although normal users should never do that.
Is it possible to still get the security update without installing GPG on the Vessel system?
Those are two independent things. The one thing is that you can verify the release files with a valid GPT signature, and that doesn't have anything to do with if you use the security repository or not.
And what would be a case when it is okay to build an ISO image with known security vulnerabilities?
I don't know about other people, but I personally do not care security at all. That means for testing an image, I don't care about security updates. That's why I exclude it.
Internal option.
Sorry?
Internal option.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is nice, but my question was, if I have an application that has created database, so how can I have
how do I open a new tab here?
Control Shift.
Open a
Control
new
Shift tab.
Let me do it. What do you want?
New tab.
Control Shift M.
Control
Shift, Shift M.
End.
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 Yeah.
Like
new. Okay. As you can see in the code, now you see the actual change root is change root named, and that's where all the stuff ends up. And if you look in the config directory, we have this directory named change root local includes.
Okay.
If you dump, if you dump, this is considered the root for the includes. If you want to fuck up the system, you do this. Now I'm going to root. Yeah, you would do this. Then you would overwrite your pass.
Okay.
ETC.
Yeah.
It's just the root. Everything you pull in there gets copied over.
You must pull there with full paths. So it must create or the path.
So
it's the same. It's the same with binary in local includes.
So if I want it, PostgreSQL, blah blah blah, and so.
Yeah.
There is a similar directory for including things on the live media. Live media means. The ISO image, maybe, or the
USB image. So if you want QMU auto boot or auto run whatever, you put it there.
Yeah, this would be
And the great thing about this is that you just need this configuration directory. You can trash everything you have. As long as you have this directory, you can always rebuild the image. And you can easily switch between different distributions if you select in change root the distributions. Oh no, sorry, that's a boost. At the moment we default to Edge so that by default users end up with a usable system. If you change that to Lenny or Sid, it puts a Sid or Lenny image. And that's really easy because if you remember back to Knoppix remaster or whatever, you can't do that. You always need to start again from scratch. And here you have the easy possibility to switch between releases and keep the config the same. And it works even with Ubuntu nowadays. So.
You could also proceed the packages at the build time, so they will be configured for the final images build. So you could prepare a proceed file with webconf questions answered where how you like, and have the system configured in a, not in the default way, but in a custom way.
But this is not this Ubuntu camp, also with live CD, this is completely different.
The historical context is this. Matt Zimmerman started to hack on internal fest tools to enable the boot of read-only media. And he called the package Casper. So we took this because the design and the approach is very good. Took this to Debian, and after sometimes we ended up with a fork because it was really hard to manage patches in between. Mm. And now syncing from Ubuntu is easier than syncing from Debian to Ubuntu.
Mm.
That's why. And the build system at the time we started in spring 2006, they were not allowed to show their build system. That's why we had to invent Life Helper. Basically, it works the same way. Frankly spoken, the Debian way has less bugs, but
yeah.
Otherwise, it's great.
What about Ubuntu?
Sorry?
That GUI that they have, I think it's called Ubuntu.
Yeah.
How do you pronounce that Ubuntu?
Ubuntu, I guess.
Yeah.
Ubuntu has an installer application which you can point on your desktop. And it uncompresses the squash-fs image to a hard disk partition and asks some questions like time zone or passwords or whatever. And the problem about this is that it's a third application you have. It's not integrated in DI. And that's why we didn't want to go that way, to support an additional installer in Debian. And with the great work of Ottavio, he did last week. The first step of it is already committed to the GI repository. Means then in future you can just put in a Debian CD, and if it's a live CD, you end up with the installed live CD on the hard disk. And if it's a normal system, it fetches the package from the internet or from the CD if it's a full CD. But from the user point of view, you don't see any difference. And that's the way to go, because then you have only one installer to support.
When this finishes, and I make the live CD, how many language options will the user have?
We do not strip the packages, means you have the same as you would have
200 and something different languages.
Yeah. By default, as we did not specify a boot parameter, that's why the default is English. If you add a language that equals, for example, DE, then GNOME will be automatically started in German with German keyboards and so on. This is nice because you do not alter Debian, which is good, and second, you have always the possibility to change the language with one CD. You can go somewhere, take it to your holidays, and depending who wants to work with it, he has the right language installed. The bad point about this is that it takes, of course, more space. If someone wants to strip that, that's also quite easy.
Yeah, don't.
In the directory, change with local hooks, here, you can put in as many scripts as you want. Those scripts are executed, they can be in every whatever language the change root can execute. So, mostly use bash. You could put, for example,
okay, and that'll be on the boot screen when it comes up.
Sorry?
If I change root local hooks and add several more languages, these will all be choices on the boot screen?
No, because we do auto-login into GNOME. We do not display the GDN for selection. If you want that, you can add a boot parameter called GNOMEX auto-login, and then it goes directly to GDN instead of auto-login.
Uh-huh.
Same for console.
Would it be possible not to have the auto-login enabled and have maybe three users, or four or ten, one called live user, and the other one for French people, and the third user for Spanish people, which are also, I just have to switch it. Instead, the user, would it be easy to do?
Why two switches?
To have many users, and the user say, just I want to have this demo CD in French, and if it's French user.
You need to use hooks for that. There are not a way on for now on the boot on Live Helper
to configure more than one user with different kind of locators and so on. We need to provide a script to do that now.
We just have to create a trap script to
write the script. The script put in those chase root.outputs will be executed on the chase root at the end of the installing phase. So you could have an opportunity to do some black magic on your system before the binary images will be built.
A bit tricky, but possible. Maybe.
Sorry?
Maybe a bit tricky, but possible.
Yes, but we cannot imagine all the use cases for that helper.
It's still a possibility.
Yeah, I want to comment that I don't like the approach of putting every locale on the CD or image because it can get really messy. I prefer to build ISOs for the particular locale, just in the smaller, I can have the exact right fonts there, and the people don't have to choose a keyboard, it just boots up to exactly what they, you know, if you're a Spanish user, have a Spanish version, just get what you want.
You can always remove the complexity from like building and booting the system to choosing the right CD.
Yeah,
some users that doesn't actually help them.
Well, you have content negotiation on the website, goes to Spanish, download.
Could be.
It's hard to make a mistake.
I mean,
so what would a school in the Spanish area in New York use? The English or the Spanish?
Okay, I think it's pretty easy to choose a right CD and in use it's really easy.
Okay, time is up.
Yep.
Yes.
Tape is out.
Okay, tape is out.